Gosh, with all this music going on, you would think that Dean would have been one of our featured soloists here at our church, with a bagpiper and wonderful show tunes about the joy of life. But I will have to admit to you, Dean didn't sing. He'd sit right over here in this section, I think mostly because he could see Eve in the choir when she was able to be in the choir, and he still liked looking at Eve. And he would stand for the hymns, and that's about it. He wouldn't sing. But we come today to honor his life that was truly filled with music and the music of faith. So on his behalf, our call to worship, let Catherine and I sing for you, "How Great Thou Art." O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Though I know Dean didn't sing, I know he listened to the words. And those are words that meant a great deal to Dean, because Dean loved God. And Dean knew that God loved him. He knew that through the one we call Jesus of Nazareth, the one Dean called Jesus, his Lord and Savior. And it is through the life, the death, and resurrection of this Jesus that we know all is well with Dean's soul. It is that vision of how life can be here on earth and how life is yet to be in God's heavenly realm that Dean clung to and by which he lived and through which he loved. And because of that, we come today to celebrate his life, despite the sadness, to celebrate his life, because he knows God, even as God has already known him. We invite you in this time of worship to join with us in ways that are good for you, to join with us in singing our opening hymn, Be Thou My Vision. There are... Be seated. I'd like to share a few pieces of scripture for you. One is requested by Eve, the others I've chosen because they remind me of Dean, and I'll tell you a little bit later why. But Dean lived his life by the word. He was a Bible student through and through. And the Bible study class was important to him, and learning was important to him. As smart as he was smart enough to know there's always something more to learn. And so he'd go to class and diligently listen and diligently learn and diligently grow in his faith, because he knew the words of the 23rd Psalm and how David had learned of God's grace. Hear them again as if perhaps they were Dean's words. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Two other pieces of scripture that I want to share with you. One comes from the Old Testament book of Joshua's. Joshua is trying to help people get settled after the Exodus experience and trying to figure out now how do they live back in this land of promise? How do they really return their life to God as God had led them through this time? And Joshua says to the people, now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you're unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me, and as for my household, we will serve the Lord. And then, in the very last book in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, in John's vision of how life can be and will be, John describes, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples. And God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, that might have even gotten Dean to tap his toe a little bit, right? I share those pieces of scripture with you because they remind me of Dean. Dean was that kind of, for me, that solid, steady, kind of faithful man who knew just simply to move through life and stay solid and steady. When Joshua was bringing the people back into the land of promise and trying to reorganize them, they had been all around the world, much like Dean and Eve have traveled. And they've seen all sorts of things and all sorts of ways to know God or to claim God. But Joshua says, look, folks, at some point in your life, you've got to claim reality and the one who is God. And as for me and my household, we choose the Lord. And Dean did that. One would think sometimes that engineers are people who have to have everything figured out. They have minds that are very different than mine. And Dean was one of the smartest men I have met. He was able to figure out a whole lot of things that were more than just things. You see, when I first arrived here many years ago, there was this gigantic pulpit that was here. It was a great big monstrosity of wood structure that was octagonal in shape, and it had an entrance from this one side here on my right that you had to step up into and proclaim the word of God from, and it was not moving, though the mountains should shake in the tumult of the sea. That pulpit was not moving. And my first year here as a pastor, new, and you know new pastors, they just try anything. When it came time for the Christmas pageant, we got a bunch of people and we moved the pulpit out and put it in the corner because we needed the space for the Christmas pageant. Now, not liking that pulpit in a round sanctuary that was meant to keep us connected, after the pageant, I didn't put it back. And people for several weeks started saying, so Steve, when are you going to put the pulpit back? I said, oh yeah, I forgot. I'll have it next week. I got busy. In the meantime, I had put a lectern in place. And pretty soon people said, are you ever going to put the pulpit back? And I finally got honest and said, not if I don't have to. Because it blocked the view of people from across here and across here. It was just too heavy when we wanted to move it and do things. And finally, we as a congregation decided it was probably okay to let go of the pulpit. Then came the decision. What do you do with the pulpit? Because you cannot simply throw it out and get rid of it. That's sacrilegious. Enter Dean, who saved my hide. He and a couple of his friends, Norm Mason and Jack Diamond and a few others, devised a plan to build the audiovisual booth that we have up there out of the wood from the pulpit. Score. It's still here, and 22 and a half years later, so am I. Thanks to Dean, who had not only the ability to figure out how to change this piece of structure and make it a structure that can hold all that needs to be held up there, but the creativity of how to make that happen. He was amazing. And for that, I will always be grateful. I know there are lots of stories in the room about Dean and ways that he's affected us, and you all will be able to share those stories in a time of fellowship after worship, after the family is left later, across the brick patio. It will be a time of fellowship, and we hope you'll come and share those stories. For now, we've asked a few people to speak. You'll know that it takes a village to raise children, and the neighborhood where Dean and Eve lived was a village. And Jeff and his friends would hang out all around. And some of his friends have come to know Dean even as their own father and would like to share some of those stories. So, gentlemen, where'd you go? Come on forward.
Hi, so my name is Greg Williams, and I have with me today Dwayne Candelario and Steve DeBolt. And Mrs. Thorburn gave me a call, and she asked if we would come and share some of our stories of growing up with Dean. So I called Dwayne on the phone, and I let him know what the request was. And I wish I could have had a tape recorder, because what ensued was a 15-minute discussion where we laughed and we told stories and we joked. And although our memories were different and we had different stories, there was a common theme that came about from the whole thing. And that the theme was basically his generosity and the fact that he was such a witty guy and his sense of humor was like, it was unbelievable. So what we're going to do today is we're going to try to recreate that phone call that we had a little bit. So I'm going to ask Dwayne if he would share some of his stories first.
I think, first of all, I'm really grateful to say a couple of words because Mr. Thorburn meant a lot to me. And I think, as I said earlier, we were raised in a community that was unbelievable. I mean, it was a community that raised us. And we would, not having a father, my father died when I was a year old. I had so many parents looking after me. And as Greg's mom stated earlier, it took a lot of looking after for me. So, there's a couple of things that stood out to me when Greg and I talked. And one is, I thought for somebody who I always thought was the most intelligent person I ever met, he had an incredible sense of humor. And one of the things that I know Mrs. Thorburn brought up with Greg was we used to call him Tut, as in King Tut. And Greg and I were trying to remember where did that name come up, And all I could remember is the Steve Martin, song. But we could never figure out exactly when it was pinned on him. But you can imagine this person with the dry sense of humor, basically being called Tut for years. And, and he was as serious as he was and as smart as he was, he had a great sense of humor about himself. And that's something that we truly appreciate. The second thing that was brought up is, how intelligent he was. And somebody that I truly respected for his intelligence. I remember coming as a little kid and visiting and the garage door would always be open, and he'd be in the garage doing something. And as a young man and as a retiree from Hughes, I always thought he was building a missile. he was so intelligent, but he could always talk to us on a separate level. And he made things interesting. Years later, I would come home after I moved away, and I'd be going on these long walks, and sure enough, I'd meet him on the street. And I'll remember having the conversations about, we catch up on family, but, the greatest conversations I always had with him were about the trips he was going to take and his planning for the trips. And it just excited me even more, So I almost, sometimes I would give him credit for getting me through college, but he was always excited about his knowledge, and it always excited me.
I'm just going to make this short and sweet.
Can't say it.
Okay, that's right. It's
all good. We were all in the same, street area. And Tut He just took care of us.
So the two stories that I will tell that speak about the theme would be his wit and his dry sense of humor and his generosity. The first one is about his sense of humor. So I was an accomplished athlete many, many, many years ago, and I got invited and went to this track meet, which was called the Drake Relays. So when I came back from the Drake Relays, I was wearing this shirt, and the shirt said Drake Relays. So Dean looks at me and he says, "Where'd you get that shirt?" And I say, "Well, I went to the Drake Relays." If anybody knows Dean, when he got ready to say something funny, first he would start to smile, and then he had that signature chuckle, and I'm thinking to myself, uh-oh, the punchline, where is it? Where is he going to go with this? And he said, "Are you sure you're wearing the right shirt? Because I've seen you run before, and maybe your shirt should say the Brake Relays." So for years and years and years, every time we saw each other, he would remind me of the Brake Relays, and which the Drake Relays, which he called the Brake Relays. And the generosity story, when we were growing up in this great neighborhood, there were always kids who wanted something. Like I remember Jeff once wanted a CB radio, and so he had to save money for the CB radio. And there were other kids in the neighborhood who wanted a bicycle, and they do things for the bicycle. Well, I was just the run-of-the-mill kid, and I never really wanted anything. All I wanted was I did sports, and I wanted the next cool pair of football shoes or track spikes. Well, my father was a coach at the University of Arizona, so I always got cool track stuff. So it was like I really didn't get excited by anything. But one day Dean was out, as Dwayne said, tinkering in his yard. And as he was tinkering around, he was making this jewelry. And there was a silver bracelet that he made, and it just caught my attention. I'm like, "Wow, look at that. That's really cool." And he's like, "Oh, well, I'll tell you what. When I get done with this," he goes, "why don't you save up your little money or whatever, and maybe I'll give you that you can buy the bracelet from me." So I would see him a couple weeks, a month later, whatever, and he'd say, "Have you saved any of that money yet?" "I'm working on it, Mr. Thorburn." So then some more time would go along, and he'd see me again. "Have you saved the money for that bracelet?" "I'm still working on it, Mr. Thorburn." But he never told me how much it cost. He just said, "Save your money for the thing." So that year at Christmas time, he came to me, and he presented me with the box, and it was a gift. And I opened up the gift, and there was the bracelet. And I'm reaching in my pockets, and I don't know what to do. And I'm like, "Well, should I get you the money that I save?" And he said, "No, you don't have to do that." He said, "Because one day you're going to need that money for something else." So that encompassed, I mean, to me, what those two stories, what Dean meant. He was incredibly funny and witty, and his generosity, and he had a huge heart. And he was a great, great man, and his legacy will live on through all the people that he touched. So thank you very much.
A good friend would also like to share some words. CW, do you want to come forward?
Well, a lot of what's been said sort of lends credibility to my story. I met Dean about 50 years ago when he was working at Texas Instruments. And TI had just taken on a contract, kind of a scary contract, two of the biggest contractors, military contractors in the United States had both failed at this. They were some really great rewards for delivering to spec and to and being early was even better, more rewarding. But there were some pretty heavy, failure penalties. And there's a lot of people at TI wondering why we took it. Dean kind of ended up being responsible for figuring out the production engineering end of the line to meet this contract, and which is just the beginning of it, but still that. And a team came together, They looked at it, and they more or less decided that they better think out of the box some, because there had to be a reason why two very large, very competent competitors had failed. And they really failed. So that meant bringing along a lot of people to think differently. A lot of people who knew how it was done to do it the way they wanted to do it. And so a small core of people, Dean being one of them, figured that out. And they brought those people along, and it's too long a tale to tell, but there's quite a bit of humor and involved, and his wit and intelligence and determination were humorous at times if you were on that side of the aisle in thinking, but maybe not so humorous if you were stuck in your ways. Anyway, the long and the short of it, they finished that contract. They didn't finish it on time. They finished it weeks ahead of time. They beat the specifications so badly, by orders of magnitude in some cases, that they literally skipped that generation that they were supposed to be producing. And they produced this marvelous result, made TI a lot of money, let TI grow very rapidly, gave the United States for decades to come air superiority. Anyway, a small group of people like that always put more in than they take out. And I kind of think that with family, projects, work, everything, that's how Dean led his life, was he had put more in than he took out.
And on behalf of his grandchildren, Michael.
So I think it's pretty weird that there's definitely a really common theme, and I can tell you right now that I wrote this already, so it's just kind of weird that it all kind of goes together. So Grandpa cared deeply about a few things: his family, church, friends, his country, and Trump. Grandma told me not to talk about politics or pick a side, but I decided to hell with that, so I'm sorry, Pastor, I heard. Okay. Oh, I meant I'm sorry for you. So I guess we're going off script on this one a little bit, but the story that I keep hearing from my grandmother about after the first stroke, he was seeing a neurologist, and this goes back to the wittiness, and she quickly figured out how Grandpa felt about a lot of things. So, you know, he still, you know, struggled a little bit, and he turned around and said to her, have you been checked out lately for your beliefs of politics? Just kind of tore her up really fast, and she was like, okay, I think that this guy's okay. So, yeah, and he obviously, and anybody that really knew him knew, he loved ice cream, loved Dairy Queen. That's one thing that we have in common for sure. So, and I heard this as well from you earlier, which was, he wasn't the most physically affectionate person, but the way that he showed that he cared and believed in things was what I think is a more meaningful way, which is through acts of service. So again, like his generosity, like you guys had said, he definitely gave more than he took out. That's what I can remember, like the more and more that I started thinking back. And he would do this through, you know, making jewelry. He helped my aunt and my mom cut wood for this Christmas decoration that they used to make. And just growing up, when we would go to Grandpa's house, it was always about what we wanted to do, what we wanted to build. And it was always a surprise for my parents of what kind of crazy stuff they were going to bring home. And he spent a lot of time at church working on a bunch of various projects. And it was cool to kind of see some of those today. And again, he really showed the way that he carried through some of his passion for his neutral political party. He was definitely the most admirable man, strongest man, smartest man I have ever met. And I'm happy to be his grandson.
What can I say on some things Dean and I disagreed? Which makes me appreciate something that Eve shared with me when she describes Dean by saying he knew who he was. I love that. He did. But he knew more than that. He not only knew who he was, he knew whose he was. And he was the Lord's. He knew that studying Scripture, when in Romans the Apostle Paul says, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. He knew that by watching other people and traveling the world. He knew that by raising a family. He knew that by falling in love with Eve, and he was deeply in love with Eve. Throughout a military career, she tells me a little story. You get to ask her more about it because she tells it way better than I could. She walked in and he checked her out. And from then on, the two were a team. And Eve, it is hard for me to talk about Dean without also talking about you and your creativity and the gifts that you have also shared in life. The way the two of you work together, Eve in front and Dean behind. There's a wonderful movie out there called Bruce Almighty. The lead character gets the powers of God and goes right to his head, of course. And he misuses those powers and he finally comes to an understanding of what life is all about. And he realizes that he left behind the woman that he really loved and the most important part of his life, and he begins to mend that. And there's a line in there that says, behind every great man, there's a woman rolling her eyes. It was, in a sense, opposite for Dean and Eve. As she was out there in the drama world and singing world, there was Dean behind her, just kind of rolling his eyes. As Eve would orchestrate things for the family or for the church or for other stuff, there was Dean mentally keeping a list of all the things he needed to do. Here's the list of all the things I needed to say today. But Dean made us promise that this wouldn't be a really long, drawn-out service. But it's hard not to be. With a man who was witty, with a wonderful, dry humor, who could really make you laugh at things that were worth laughing at. He was honest. Yes, maybe a little shy in crowds, but he still knew himself, and he'd warm up to you soon. And Dean loved his family. As you've come in, you've seen some of those pictures. In a few moments, you'll see some more. He loved his family. And as you've heard, he loved in a way that made others feel like they were part of his family too. What a gift. He wasn't a guy to draw attention to himself. He was a guy to help you do what you needed to do. And I will always be grateful that I got to be his pastor, because he has helped me become who I am. He's shown me in Revelation that there is a vision for this world that God has. And you and I look around at the ways that we disagree are awful, and the ways in many times that we treat each other are, they're terrible. But Dean held on to a vision of a new heaven and a new earth where life could be really lived in God's word and in God's way. And he never let any disagreement get in the way of him doing that. Quietly, behind the scenes, strongly living as a rock of faith. Hallelujah. What a gift of a man he was. There are so many things to say about him. A man who could dress up in a suit and then go home and wrap himself in his prayer shawl that he had been given, that he loved. A man who could travel to the Arctic Circle and all around the world and still come home because he loved home. A man who had an engineering mind that could figure out all the kinds of things that he and CW had to figure out for the projects. And yet a man who with creativity made jewelry, and you'll see on the family some of the pieces of jewelry that he made. A man who could not only make an AV sound booth, but some of the finest tongue and groove furniture I've ever seen that Eve has in her home. A man who could take yard junk and make it yard art. If you haven't been to their home, peek over the wall sometime, let Eve know you're coming. But wow, there are some strange pieces in their backyard that are actually really beautiful. This is a man who not only knew who he was, he knew whose he was. And he was the Lord's. And so today I join with voices in saying thank you. Thank you, God, for Dean Thorburn. Let's watch a video for a few moments of some wonderful family moments of love and history. So I direct your attention to the screen behind me. Dean was a man who loved God through Jesus the Christ. Dean was a man who loved Eve. Dean was a man who loved his family. Dean was a man who loved his church. Dean was a man who loved his country. And he served them all faithfully, quietly, strongly. Which is different than me, who tends to be loud and out there. But Dean reminds me of how to live biblically. Hear this from Matthew chapter 6. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who is in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who's in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. We're all a little bit different. One of the things I learned from Dean is the importance of my own relationship with God in Christ. Beyond what I might share here, Dean simply lived it. He built it. He loved it. And for that lesson, and those big bushy eyebrows, I will always be grateful to God for Dean Thorburn. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for Dean and for allowing us to be a part of his life, for learning how to live because of the way he loved. Thank you for everything about him. The things that brought us joy and the things that sometimes frustrated us. We give to you the words we said we now wish we hadn't, and the words we didn't say we now wish we had. Because we know he loved us no matter what. Teach us to love like Dean did. To live as Dean did, as a faithful one in you. We know. We've talked a lot about him today. But he was truly one of your good ones, God. May our living be a reflection of your loving and the loving we've seen in Dean. To you we now give him back, knowing that it's all well with him. We ask your loving spirit to be made known around Eve, around Jeff and his family, and Mindy and hers, around his friends, around his church, his community, and this world, so that together we can live in ways that honor you forever. In your name we pray. Amen. I invite you to rise and sing together a great hymn that honors Dean and honors our country. Number 561, My Country, 'Tis of Thee. May you now go out into your life and live it as well, or even better, as Dean did. Take what was good in him and make it better in yourself. And imagine how the world could be if we all did that. Think on the things that Dean has done to make our lives better. May we do that for others and for all. For it is to that that God has called us in Jesus the Christ. His was a life well lived. Well done, good and faithful servant. God is with him even as he is with God. May you know that too. And may that peace reign forever in all of us. After the families left the sanctuary, we do invite you to come across the patio and for a time of fellowship and greeting them. Peace be with us all. Amen.